Hey folks, welcome to a brand new episode of Smart Money. Now, I have a very special guest joining me today. She's a YouTube sensation with over 1.5 million subscribers and many of her educational videos on various topics of the stock market and the financial markets have garnered millions of views. The basics of stock market video of hers has seen more than 9 million views as of now. She started off as a lecturer, she went on to become an investor, and she has pursued her passion, been a long-term investor for over 12 years, and now is furthering the cause of financial education through the YouTube platform. Let me welcome the very popular Rachna Ranade to our show today. Rachna, thank you so much for speaking to us on CNBC TV 18. This is your first television interview. Of course, you've spoken on YouTube multiple times, but how do you feel?
Wow, I am getting goosebumps right now, but I'm feeling very awesome at the same time. I had mentioned this on my social media handle as well, like when I started investing in stock market way back in 2006, I used to watch CNBC TV 18. That was the first ever TV channel that I started to see which was related to stock markets. Never ever in my wildest dream had I thought that maybe 14 years later I would be on this same TV show.
Okay, so congratulations, but you've, you know, done really well for yourself. I was just talking about how you have a huge fan following on YouTube. You've sort of monetized your platform as well. We have a lot of millennial young crowd watching us on our channel and on our shows. If you had to give them some advice on how to take their passion and monetize their content on YouTube, how did you make this transition?
I'll be very honest with you, Sonia, that there are many people who started their YouTube channels during the lockdown. So like number of DMAT accounts shot up during the lockdown, same way even YouTube channels shot up. But you know, as and how things started getting back to routine, I think the number of active DMAT have gone down. Similarly, the number of active YouTubers have also somewhere gone down. So I think you should do something which you feel that you can do for a longer period of time. You should do it only and only if it is your passion. Don't follow someone else blindly, because I could see so many people that, hey, Rachna is doing this, XYZ is doing this, let me try it out my way as well. So you should have that absolute passion for doing YouTube videos. You need a lot of consistency to do YouTube videos. So for example, I post a video every Wednesday, every Saturday without fail. Number three, you have to give quality content. You have to differentiate yourself from others. That's where you will be standing out as compared to others. And if you are following these two, three basic things, then, well, there are so many ways to monetize your channel. Just to give you one or two quick examples. Number one, you will get advertisement revenue. Number two, you can get revenue from merchandise once you start becoming known to many people. Number three, you can also enable memberships on your channel. So it's like you ask for paid subscriptions from your members. One very interesting way to monetize your YouTube channel can also be enabling supers or monetizing the super chats on your channel.
Okay.
I'll just give you a quick example on that as well. So when I was doing a live stream for Burger King IPO, that was like an amazing live stream, an amazing experience that I had. There were almost more than 10,000 people who were watching me live on that day. And you know, the questions were running up at such a huge speed that I was not able to read even a single comment.
Okay.
So if a viewer wants to grab my attention, that's where he gives a paid chat for me. So I got a paid chat saying that, hey, you are doing a good job. So feels good when even if people are giving you $1,000, but just for saying that, hey, you're doing a good job, feels really good.
Okay,
so that's also another way to monetize your channel.
This is very exciting, you know, but I want to ask you, Rachna, now social media has become a very cluttered space, don't you think? How do you differentiate? Because you said that a lot of your stuff is, you need to subscribe to get sort of your content, but there's so much free stuff available online as well. So A, how do you differentiate? And B, what would your tips be? Okay, we'll do one thing. We'll just sort of get chatting with Rachna in a bit. But as you heard her say, she's been a YouTube sensation, 1.5 million subscribers. And of course, her basics of stock market, you know, video that she's put out has got almost 9 million views on YouTube and a whole host of subscribers as well. I'm going to talk to her about many issues. One is she's been an investor in the market for over, I think, 12 to 15 years now. So I'm going to ask her what are her tips tips for people who are getting started in this investment arena. And I'm also going to talk to her about how she picks multi-baggers. All right, Rachna, I think you're back with us. So let me just once again ask you that question, if you can hear me well. Okay, great. I was asking you about how this is a very cluttered space, right? Social media is so cluttered, and you are charging for a lot of your products as well. A, how do you differentiate from this cluttered space? And B, given that there's so much free information out there, do people really subscribe?
Yeah, so I'll tell you how I pitch for it. I always tell all my subscribers, I always tell all my viewers that everything and anything is available free of cost online. But the problem is that there is so much that you don't know exactly what is to be consumed on the net. So if you have so much on the plate, you really get confused that if I have limited space to eat, what out of this entire thing am I going to consume? Similarly, I tell them that if you enroll for my courses, if you enroll for my memberships, I'll be giving you only that much knowledge which will help you to enter the stock markets, which will bring up your confidence to the next level if you were to start your investment journey. And the most foremost important thing I feel is that I tell them that I don't sell knowledge, I sell simplified knowledge. That's where I feel I have a little bit of upper hand, because being in the teaching space for like more than 10 years, I feel I have the ability to simplify concepts to the masses.
Okay, simplified knowledge. I think that's what everyone wants these days, right? So you've worn your hat as a YouTuber, you've worn your hat as a teacher, but now wear your hat as an investor. You've been investing in the market for over a decade now, if I'm not wrong. How do you pick stocks? I mean, that is the ultimate question that everyone wants the answer to, right? How do you identify wealth creators?
Again, I'll tell you that when we hear of stories, people would say that I bought MRF when it was like whatever, in few hundred rupees. I bought Infosys when it was in few hundred rupees. But being very honest, I feel very few retailers, the retail individual investors, they'll be very handful who will be able to pick up a stock at the very initial stage of the journey. Mm. And even if they pick up stocks at the initial phase of the journey, let us say they pick 10, not all 10 might be able to take off. Out of 10, barely one or two might be able to take off. So I always tell the retail individual investors that don't pick up stocks when they're too early, when these stocks are not visible to people. Try to pick them up when they have proven themselves a little bit. Mm-hmm. That's where the chances of you losing out on money at least reduces. You might not get a 10x multi-bagger. I feel that as a retail individual investor, I'm really happy even if I get a 2x returns on stocks. So what I do typically is I prefer a top to bottom approach. I would do an economy analysis followed by industry analysis and then the company analysis. So in the current scenario, if I'm talking about, I would say that, okay, because now we are in a scenario where we have a strong news that the vaccine is coming up, then I would just try to think through that which industries would be getting benefited out of this. If I were to think from the economy perspective, I would try to check out the demography of our country right now. Does it suit that industry or not? I would try to correlate it. And once I drill down to a specific industry, then I would go ahead with choosing a company. Okay. And you know, typically we use this concept actually for banks, but I try to use this for other companies as well, the camel model. Mm-hmm. So many of you might be knowing this, but C stands for the capital adequacy. I would just say check out the capital structure. Then A stands for the asset quality. Then M stands for the management quality. E stands for the earnings visibility. And for L also, you can check out how much is their liability position. L of course has multiple interpretations, but that's how you can choose down or drill down to a specific company for choosing a multi-bagger. One or two small points which I generally try to check up is, ideally they should be having a monopoly in that space or at least less competition in the space. And if they are like the leaders in that segment, then nothing like it.
Okay, the camel model, that's very, very good especially for someone who's just starting off, right? These are some benchmarks that one should follow. But since you said that you've mastered the art of simplified knowledge, simplify some ratios for us. Everyone talks about debt equity, everyone talks about price to earnings. What's the one or two ratios that you definitely look at, and what's your marker, what's your filter?
Okay, so the first and foremost ratio that I always check out while filtering out companies is ROE or ROCE. So if you're talking about investing in a company, if I were the owner of the company, and if I'm not able to generate even 5% returns out of the company, then might as well I invest my money in fixed deposits. So 5% for for an ROE, I feel is like very less. If I'm investing in any company, then I'm risking out my money a little bit. So I would expect at least twice or thrice returns from as compared to an FD. So I would go ahead with a minimum 15% ROE. Similar case, I would check for ROCE. So any company which doesn't meet this criteria, it doesn't come up in my filtering list also. So that is the first benchmark I check for. Second, I also check out how much is the free cash flow. I know it's not a ratio as such, but other than ratios, that's what I give utmost importance to, because I've seen companies which have good operating cash flows, but because they have very less free cash flows, I feel over the longer term, let's say 3 years, 4 years back to back, they're having very low or negative free cash flows. I feel that somewhere they are struggling with managing the funds, and that company might not perform well in the future. So I prefer to stay away from such companies which have negative or very low operating cash flows or even free cash flows. Apart from these two things, third and the last thing which I would like to tell you is I definitely try to check out the valuation ratios, PE ratio, PB ratio, EV, EBITDA. I would check price to sales. So I think all these ratios help me as an individual investor to see whether the stock is pricey or not right now. If I feel like it's very expensive, I would better stay away from the company. I know there's no standard benchmark, but you know, typically comparing it with peers or comparing it with the industry average would help me to take an informed decision.
Okay, I must say, Rachna, for someone who's appearing on television for the first time, you're mighty confident. I mean, I don't think anyone will you know, look at your interview and say that this is your first television appearance. But I have many more questions for you lined up. And I also want to ask you about how you stumbled upon this YouTube, you know, sensation that you've made of yourself. And was it planned or did it just happen? But all that and more lined up on the other side of the break. Don't go anywhere. The most engaging conversation on Smart Money coming up in just a bit.